Hello everyone, and thank you for joining us today. Welcome to AVO's Electrical Training Today monthly webinar series. I hope that everyone is staying safe out there today, and thank you for joining us. Today's topic is electrical safety for industrial facilities. And my name is Jamie Smith, and I'm the marketing manager for AVO Training Institute. And I'll be acting as the moderator for today's presentation and supporting you on any technical issues or questions for our presenter. And on the right side of your screen, you will see a control panel that looks similar to this one. You can submit questions at any time during the presentation by typing in the box highlighted in red, and I will read those questions out during the Q&A segment after the presentation portion of the webinar. All live webinar attendees are eligible to receive one NEDA CTD and one PDH or 0.1 CEU for attending, and you will receive that in an email within 2 to 3 business days of the webinar. And that email will also include a copy of the PowerPoint presentation and a link to a video recording of the webinar if you'd like to watch it again or share it with your colleagues. So remember, you can ask questions at any time during the presentation, and they will be answered at the end of the webinar during the Q&A session. And before we get started, I just wanted to give a brief history of AVO and announce some of our recent updates. I know we have a lot of new people that that register for these webinars every month, so just want to give a brief history. First off, AVO was founded in 1963 as a subsidiary of Megger, and we held our first do-it-yourself workshop on April 16, 1963 in Cranford, New Jersey. Over 57 years have passed, and AVO remains the industry leader in providing electrical safety and maintenance training. We're also the only major training company that focuses solely on electrical. Most other training companies, you know, kind of venture out into other areas, but we, you know, stick to just electrical. We offer over 60 different ISET accredited courses. ISET stands for International Association for Continuing Education and Training, and they created the first Continuing Education Unit, or CEU. AVO instructors are the core of our business, and what truly set us apart. Our instructors average close to 30 years of industry experience each. We also recently moved into a brand new headquarters training facility in Dallas earlier this year with a lot more square footage. New equipment, and the combination of labs and classrooms for an ideal learning environment for our students. You know, unfortunately for the time being, we postponed our in-person training, our open enrollment courses due to COVID-19, but, you know, hopefully we're able to bring those back sooner rather than later, and we do have a lot of new ideas. Luckily, since the classrooms are larger, we're going to be able to, you know, space students out more, provide masks to our students, hand washing stations. We also have, we're gonna have kiosks in front of the building that students are allowed to check their temperatures without touching anything before even entering the building, just to make sure, you know, our staff, employees, and the students are all safe. So those are some ideas we have, and, you know, we hope to offer here in the near future. In the meantime, we're also gonna start bringing back our on-site training for companies that have groups to train. And that training will be, in order for that to take place, we'll obviously have some, you know, some guidelines as far as where we can hold, what cities we could hold those in, you know, as well as some other safety precautions that we'll have to follow. And that'll be on a case-by-case basis. But I didn't want to make y'all aware of that. Okay, and the next slide. Our new live virtual online training is something I also want to make you aware of. This is something that allows our students to train remotely from anywhere in the world through a virtual interactive experience. This is another option we've recently released. Perfect timing for everything that's going on, and with people, a lot of people working from home and not able to travel. But this really allows students to log into an online classroom with a live instructor. You're still able to ask questions, answer polls, take tests, and access all the course materials and more digitally. Enrollment costs are, you know, close to 30% cheaper than our in-person training courses, and really help you save on not just enrollment costs, but also the employee travel costs. You have the option to choose between pre-scheduled open enrollment dates, or you can ask about our virtual on-site training if you have a large group of students that need training as well. And not to mention, you or your employees can continue practicing social distancing while learning, which is the most important at these times. Also, some of those current virtual courses include electrical safety for industrial facilities, which is a four-day class. The class we're actually speaking about today, or giving you a brief overview today for the webinar. Electrical safety for utilities, which is a four-day class. NEC 2020, NFPA 70E, which is also offered in Spanish, as well as NEC changes 2020. We also have a few newer virtual electrical maintenance courses that are coming soon that are based off of some of our hands-on courses. Those will include substation maintenance, protective relay maintenance, and low voltage circuit breaker maintenance. All right. And let's see. And since the webinar is a very condensed version of our electrical safety for industrial facilities training course, which is normally, which includes 4 days of lecture, I thought it was important just to provide a little additional detail on the full course for those of you that might be interested in taking a deeper dive into the full course now that we offer it virtually. Our normal course is offered 4 days in person and is obviously a lot more in depth. Students receive 2.8 CEUs, and the course also counts towards our substation maintenance technician certification program. The pricing for the in-person course is normally $14.20 per person, but this new live virtual online training is only $9.90, so significant savings there. To learn more or enroll, you can visit our website at abotraining.com /ESIFV, or you can select request quote in the survey after the webinar, and we'll be happy to have someone reach out to you to answer any questions. All right, let's go ahead and I want to give also a quick bio on our presenter today, Ralph Carrillo, who is AVO Lead Senior Training Specialist. Ralph's an essential part of the AVO team and has over 39 years of experience in the electrical industry. Five of those were in electrical supervision and 23 years of hands-on experience. He's trained with AVO for 19 years now. He started off with the Brownsville Public Utilities Board for 20 years, which included multiple roles as electric meter shop supervisor, chief meterman, electrical engineer, field project coordinator, and underground lineman. He had way too many certifications and associations for me to all fit on them here today, but I did list a few just so you can get an idea. Some of those include electronics, certified field ambassador, International Association of Electrical Inspectors, Certified ERCOT Meter Facility Inspector, Certified Medium Voltage Cable Technician at AVO, Certified Basic Relay Maintenance Technician, and Certified Substation Maintenance Technician. Needless to say, you know, Ralph is a very credible resource and valuable member of the AVO team. So let's go ahead and get started. Thank you for joining us today, Ralph.
Thank you. Good morning, Jamie. Good morning, everybody that is here. Welcome to ABO training. We're going to try and basically talk about a four-day course in 1 hour or less than 1 hour. So we get started real quick. We're going to be talking about hazards that we encounter when we're working with electricity. Now, electricity, I consider it a monster. I've been working with it most all of my life. And this monster actually electrocuted or killed my father when I was 10 years old. And for some reason, I decided to take this career. And again, we must be careful. We must be on watch 100% of the time. So let's talk about the problems we have with the with working with electricity. We have accidents. Again, we have fatalities. Electrical accidents can be catastrophic, but they can be preventable. According to some statistics, we could have done better. A job of protecting people. So this course basically offers companies and employers and students to how to make sure that we go home basically with all our fingers and toes and limbs, or vertical for that matter, and not go into a morgue. So we're going to be talking about the qualified worker, and the qualified worker must be trained to recognize these dangers that we're going to be having while we're exposed to this monster. This monster has what we call the shock hazard, the arc flash hazard, and the blast hazard. When we encounter a fault or we do a short circuit, again, everybody knows that the shock hurts. It basically hurts your elbow, your jaw sometimes. Some people have been able to taste copper when they get shocked. And then we're going to be talking a little bit brief about the arc flash hazard and the blast explosion hazard. So again, electrical shock causes or happens when we have a difference in electrical potential from one part of the body to another. A current will flow. Because we are very good conductors, we will actually conduct electricity. And when we have a difference in potential going across our body, then a current will flow. The amount of current will depend on several factors. What type of circuit we're working with? Is it an AC circuit, a DC circuit? The voltage, is it low voltage, medium voltage, high voltage? Again, there's no standard, but if we look at NEDA, and that's what we do in this class, we look at NEDA standards, and they have a definition of what is low voltage, medium voltage, and high voltage, and we use that on our classes. The resistance of the body. Now, some people are heavyweight, some people are very slim and trim, and those are the most dangerous. The ones that are slim and trim can actually conduct more current, and they're more danger if they become in contact with this circuit. The pathway through the body, is the current going to go from hand to hand or hand to foot, and how long you're connected to the circuit? I heard an incident once, and one of my students that said one of his coworkers was in contact with a circuit for 8 minutes. That is too much time. Apparently, the body cannot sustain that, and the person died in the first few minutes, for first few seconds, actually. So current as low as 50 milliamperes can disrupt your normal heartbeat. It all depends on how weak your heart is also. Voltage levels as low as 50 volts can cause fibrillation, which throw your heart out of timing. It's like your timing chain on your car, on your vehicle. If that gear jumps one gear on the timing chain, that automobile will actually sputter and knock until it eventually dies later. And the same thing happens to a person's heart. It may continue working, but then stop. At higher currents, we have heart stoppage, which is possible. About 4 amps of current, it will completely stop the heart. And that's where we come in with OSHA's recommendations that we have CPR training. And they recommend that if we do have available AEDs, artificial external defibrillators, available at the worksite, would be a lot better for the person that's doing the electrical work. Current causes damage to tissue, muscle, bone, nerves, blood vessels, internal organs, and anything else it passes through. So we have to make sure that we don't generate a current. So a current high enough can cause third-degree burns internally and externally. And OSHA says that third-degree burns are very difficult to heal. And sometimes hospitals can't do anything but watch that part of the body sizzle. So burning effects may not show up for weeks or months or even years. And all this we discuss on this course and let students know. The other thing that electricity can cause is muscular contractions. People have been known to fall off ladders, fall off scaffolds, because current causes a person to be unable to release the conductor. Sometimes we grab on and we get more current. And remember, the duration of contact is what causes the damage to the body. The severity is directly related to the magnitude of the current flow and how long we're connected to the circuit. So here we have a picture of a person, making contact with a live circuit, and a frame or a earth or a ground cable. And notice the current path going from hand to hand goes through the heart, or it can go from the heart to the legs and down the feet. It all depends on where the earth is a lot easier to get to. Current loops for earth, tries to go back to the generator, basically. Electrical shock continued. The resistance of the electrical path is a major factor. Standing on concrete that can be more dangerous Again, or can be as dangerous standing on the ground, again, because the National Electrical Code and OSHA consider concrete a very good ground surface. Concrete is a very good earth. Sometimes they call this ground a UFO earth, or a very good earth connection. Electrical resistance, again, dry shoes can be significantly can add resistance to the circuit. And again, isolate a person. The problem is this shouldn't be used as secondary, not primary. Primary should be your gloves, your rubber gloves, rubber blankets, rubber sleeves, whatever you're using, and then your shoes are only designed for secondary voltages. I believe they're anything below 1,000 volts. The electrical hazard rated shoes can add additional secondary protection where the hazards of step and touch potential, and that's another topic we cover on this course in detail. The heat exposure to an employee is done by the arc flash. The arc flash damage, it depends on the distance that the person is standing or sitting from the arc and the duration of the arc, the how long it takes that overcurrent protective device to operate. The longer that breaker takes to trip, the more damage to the person. So again, how far you are and how long it takes to trip. An employee can be seriously injured or even killed at a distance of greater than 10 foot from the arc. So in this course, we actually talk about the three limits of approach, which are the shock limits of approach, which is the limited approach boundary, the restricted approach boundary, and the arc flash boundary. So we try to keep people from getting burned. So the arc flash creates an extremely high temperature that can basically ignite clothing also. This temperature is equal to four times the surface of the sun, approximately 35,000 degrees Fahrenheit. And when this arc flash happens, it vaporizes metal, turns it into steam. We breathe the steam into our lungs and it cools down, becomes metal again. And then there's nothing the doctors in the hospital can do to protect you or cure you if you have breathed in metal that's now cooled down. Now it's inside your lungs. All this metal can also be in burning, and when it lands on your clothing, it will ignite your clothing. This arc flash also causes external burning of the skin, either first, second, or third degree burns. Here we have a human tissue tolerance, and we start at 1/10 of a second. Imagine you can get burned second degree and third degree at 1/10 of a second. The longer that arc takes to develop, the easier your body is going to be burned. Notice how those slopes, those lines slope downward. As time is increased, the longer the breaker takes to trip, the easier the body is going to be burned, second or third degree burns. The National Fire Protection Association 70E standard article 130.5 talks about the arc flash boundary in detail, and we discuss that in the course. And this boundary is an approach limit from an arc source at which incident energy equals 1.2 calories per centimeter square. Again, we talk about calories, we talk about the arc thermal performance value, and we talk about the EBT, which is the threshold, break open threshold. And the NFPA 70E talks about an arc flash risk assessment that has to be done if there's a likelihood of an arc flash injury can occur. So the potential severity of the injury or damage to a health has to be taken into consideration. And the National Electrical Code also requires that we put warning labels, install warning stickers on our equipment to help the employee make good choices. The recommended arc flash warning label shown here, showing the ANSI standards, which are the exclamation mark on a black background, and then we have the orange background, the warning word there. It can also be danger. And again, the date on the sticker is not required, but ABO does those assessments, and we can actually put the date so the owner of the equipment can tell when they need to review that equipment again. Now, again, if nothing changes, you don't have to redo the assessment, but every 5 years it has to be reviewed. So now we have a date where we can check for every 5 years. The label will have the information of the protection recommended for the person that's going to be exposed to energized equipment. And again, we have the clothing, the PPE that's going to be required, and of course, materials, the rating of the equipment. We also require that we put the name of the equipment that the sticker is going to be attached to on there. And again, the voltage, so we can choose the proper class of gloves. We'll talk about PPE a little bit later. So all this is on the sticker. The problem we have with the arc flash is that people get burned, and they found out that the younger the person is, the greater chances of surviving this first, second, and third degree burn. The older we get, as you see on this chart here, we go to 50, 59 years old, the older you get, the lower the chances of surviving a second, third degree burn. So again, the statement here that we show is that the chance of survival for a person who has received a major body burn, where a significant percentage of the body receives third-degree burn, is often less than 50%. Doctors and nurses have calculated that your age plus the percent of burn, if they total 100%, you're not going to survive, and you're going to be a statistic. So again, the older we get, the less burns we're supposed to receive, but hopefully nobody wants to get burned at all. The next danger we have with working with this monster is the arc blast. This arc will actually create an expansion of air, and a pressure wave occurs from the fault current during the arc flash. It vaporizes copper. It basically expands 67,000 times itself. In other words, 1 inch cubed of copper turns into 1.44 yards cubed of vapor. So it expands itself 67,000 times. This expulsion of material that are near vaporized droplets of molten metal are coming at you at a very high rate of speed. And when they land on your clothing, if it's not FR, it will ignite. Even cotton will ignite. So all this is propelled up to 10 foot or more from the arc. So we have to make sure that we understand the limits of approach if there's an arc, a chance that might happen. The expansion of the air produces an explosion. Again, molten metal coming at you, fragmented metal like a grenade can penetrate your body sometimes. So that's what we have, arc blast blankets. They're bulletproof blankets, and high temperatures are developed also by the blast. They're going to be exposed to the body, pressure from the body, and a concussive injury also happened. Sound levels have been recorded up to 165 decibels. So the standards that we talk in this class, we require that we have some kind of hearing protection. And the problem we have is sometimes we have people that have, or customers that have electrical rooms, and they make an office inside that electrical room. And the standards we talk about require that we do not use this electrical rooms as office, or walkways, or warehouses. I've gone to do pre-OSHA inspections, and I found bicycles, barbecue pits inside the electrical rooms, and they're not supposed to be there. So again, we talk about this in the class, and again, students actually tell us, well, we have this and we have that, and that's not supposed to be there. We should not take breaks inside an electrical room. What are the chances of this monster showing up while you're taking a break? So again, this is what happened in a situation where the monster showed up, and an explosion that was basically aggravated by a leak in gas that went into the building here. Again, it made it a little bit more destructive, like you show here. Moving on to what causes accidents. If people would only understand what causes accidents, that would be a little bit more cautious. Sometimes when somebody arrives at the hospital, you ask them, well, what happened? And the first thing they respond is, I didn't know. So if you didn't know, what were you doing there? And that's what we talk about this in this section, where we talk about what causes electrical accidents. According to OSHA, accidents don't just happen. There are three contributing factors that cause electrical accidents: equipment and installations. Again, sometimes equipment is not installed as per manufacturer's recommendations and instructions, and the equipment may fail. The environment in the workplace, again, we have water, moisture, condensation. That is not a very good environment when we have electrical circuits. And the employee work performances, than unsafe. Sometimes we choose wrong choices. Sometimes we continue to work energized. We do maintenance stuff energized. Oh, it's just going to take a couple of minutes, so I don't have to go turn on the main, and that gets people in trouble. So getting back to the equipment, faulty installation causes people to get hurt or injured or killed. We had an incident in one of the classes that the student was talking to. He was wrapping an extension cord on his arm, and it was defective. The insulation and the jacket were cut, and he got himself shot. Improper grounding. A lot of people don't understand the difference between grounds and neutrals. And according to the national code, we're not supposed to connect them together on the distribution side. So again, people don't understand what's the difference between a ground and a neutral. Loose connections can also cause people to get hurt or injured or killed also. Defective parts. How many times have you bought an appliance and it's missing parts or it doesn't work? And it says inspected by 89, but that equipment wasn't inspected. So again, we have to make sure that we do a commissioning or we check the equipment before we start it. According to NEDA, we're supposed to do an acceptance test. So ground faults in equipment can also cause people to get in trouble. And OSHA cites about 40,000 citations of unguarded equipment, missing knockouts, open doors, missing panels. So that is considered a violation. And again, we talk about the environment. Environment can cause also people to get in trouble, flammable vapors, liquids, gases, corrosive atmospheres, especially in battery rooms, battery locations. And wet and damp locations can cause people to get injured or killed, or slip and fall, which is not an electrical accident, but again, can cause lost work days. So contributing factors to electrical accidents continue. Employees' unsafe work performances, failure to de-energize. That's one of the most common problems we have. Again, the standards recommend that we de-energize if we're going to be doing any adjustments, modifications, maintenance, lubrication. It must be off and locked out and tagged out again and in a safe, what they call an electrical safe work condition. And intentional use of obviously defective and unsafe tools. How many times have we seen screwdrivers wrapped with vinyl tape? And that again, that's an unsafe work performance. Use of tools or equipment too close to energized parts. And the last one, horseplay, which rarely gets reported because it's immediate termination if you get hurt while you're horse playing. All right, summary to this section of the ESIF talks about the three hazards. The best way to avoid an accident is to stay out of the circuit. And again, we have proper PPE that's available, and employees are responsible for their own safety. In my class, I tell everybody, always protect number one, and number one is yourself. Moving on to the electrical safety regulations and standards that we have to abide by. Again, sometimes it is hard to identify what they mean. And in this class, we talk about the standards and regulations in detail. Occupational Safety and Health Administration, called OSHA, gives us information. It was basically enacted back in December of 1970, when Mr. Richard Nixon was president. And they made an act to ensure safe and helpful working conditions for working men and women. And it expands on to obligations to the employer. The obligation has an obligation shall furnish to each of the employees employment and a place of employment which are free from recognized hazards that are causing or are likely to cause death or physical harm to their employees. And again, the employers are responsible to comply with occupational safety and health standards promulgated under this act. Employees also have an obligation, and we discussed this also in the class, where the employee shall comply with occupational safety and health standards and rules, regulations, and others issued pursuant to this act, which are applicable to his or her own actions and conduct. In other words, we are responsible for our own safety. Again, if we get injured, chances are we are at blame. Again, the general duty clause, which we just talked about, is the avenue through which safety standards developed and distributed by organizations and employers other than OSHA may be enforced by OSHA. So when you get a safety book, OSHA basically backs up that safety book from your employer 100%. Industry consensus standards, we have to follow the NFPA 7E, which is the National Electrical Code. Again, we have information on grounding. Again, most of the NFPA, the National Electrical Code, Article 250 covers grounding. We have the NFPA 70B, which is a very good manual that came out of the OSHA standard, OSHA industry book. And again, the standard for electrical safety in the workplace, I'm sorry, the NFPA B is a safety book for maintenance on electrical equipment. And the NFPA 70E is a standard for electrical safety in the workplace. We also have the American National Standards Institute, ANSI, under the oversight of IEEE. And again, ANSI basically covers the National Electrical Safety Code, which is most utility type installations workbook or safety book. The National Electrical Code shown here revised on a 3-year cycle. Again, the NFPA has been responsible for this information since 1911. And there are no work procedures in the NFPA 70 book. So always follow your manufacturers and your employers' information. The NFPA 70E, again, developed under the request of OSHA. And because people were not reading the General Industry Standard, which is a very thick book, and all this information is hidden in that book, electricians were not looking at the standards that we require. So this book is revised every 3 years, and the latest one came out in 2018. This is developed under the cross-section of industry and electrical organizations. And ABO is a part of these committees. We have two instructors that are basically members. We have an instructor and an engineer that's a member of this committees that actually work on the NFPA renovations. This book provides safe work practices for working on equipment near or near utilization equipment. And the primary source for electrical hazards assessments is done inside this book. We also have the safety maintenance book called the NFPA 70B book that we can also refer to how to do maintenance safe. And I recommend supervisors should have this in their industry, in their library of these books. And the National Electrical Safety Code is the one I used to cover or follow the most due to working for a utility company. Again, we follow this to the dot. The summary to this, talking about standards and regulations, OSHA regulations and industry standards are developed for the practical safeguarding of employees, people. They require written procedures, personal protective equipment, and safe work, and also training. That's why ABO is here, so we can take that part of the burden away from the employer. We can train and certify people. The compliance of this regulation is mandated by OSHA and protection of employees. So OSHA says that everybody must be trained, even non-electrical people must be trained in the dangers. The next topic would be de-energized work, where we basically look at what the NFPA 70E book under Article 120 recommends that we de-energize before we start any maintenance or modifications or lubrication on equipment. Again, unless it's more dangerous to de-energize. So let's look and see what we have in here. It says here de-energized work can be as hazardous or sometimes more dangerous as energized because a lot of people let their guard down. And when they let the guard down, again, they remove their PPE, stuff like that. But the problem is only part of the system is de-energized sometimes. If you open a cabinet and you remove the breaker, you still have a live bus at the inside that cabinet. You still have control power. You still have lighting circuits. You still have heaters that are energized, even though the breaker is removed. And we need to make sure that we protect ourselves if we're going to be sticking any part of our bodies into a cabinet. 75% of all accidents, according to statistics, occur on circuits presumed to be de-energized. And that's what happened to my father. He was told the circuit was de-energized and it wasn't totally de-energized. Only part of the circuit was off. And he understood wrong. So again, lack of communication, lack of, PPE, stuff like that. Induced or backfeed voltage can also cause a person to be in danger. Procedures must be developed and utilized according to our standards that we talked about earlier. and work should only be performed while the equipment is energized if we can prove or justify that de-energizes introduces a greater hazard. Sometimes we have life support equipment and stuff like that, or ventilation that cannot be de-energized. So we have to have a very good justification why we're going to be doing it energized. If it's infeasible due to the design or operational limitations of the equipment, and of course, for troubleshooting or testing circuits, thermography, infrared picture taking, again, has to be done live. Otherwise, you won't get a hot spot. And de-energized work should be the primary mode of operation. Find a way to de-energize, and again, it must be done safe. We have, when we de-energize, we have energies that are considered primary energies that have to be disconnected or relieved or locked or blocked or gagged. We have electrical energy has to be locked and tagged out. We have hydraulic, pneumatic have to be relieved. Mechanical and gravity also can be a very dangerous energy. We also have secondary energies we look at induced voltages. When we have two cables or two circuits paralleling each other, they can induce a source into the de-energized. And we also have backfeed voltages. We have a capacitor that keep a charge. Capacitive elements like medium voltage cables can also stay charged. And we find that out when we test in our substation courses, when we test insulation, it takes a while for that insulation to discharge sometimes. And also we have accumulators and tanks that hold energy. And if they're not relieved or blocked, they can actually come back and hurt people. The energizing should be done by a qualified person or authorized person. Again, we need to make sure that it is done correctly. An effective lockout tagout program must be thoroughly planned, systematically executed, rigorously verified every time we are going to be doing lockout tagout. Again, qualified people, we're going to be looking at that a little bit more long this session. OSHA's 1910-147 talks in detail about lockout tagout of all energies, not only electrical. The OSHA Federal Register under 1910-147 says that over half of all energy control accidents could have been prevented if we would have only practiced lockout tagout. And that happens at home too. I had a circuit that I just threw the switch on the wall and tried to change a fixture that was on the outside of the house, and my wife turned that circuit on me, and a good thing I was not making contact. Under 1910-147, all energies must be locked out or tagged or otherwise disabled to prevent accidental re-energization, startup of equipment, movement, crushing, and stuff like that. So, again, we must lock out energies. Here's a picture of a lock and a tag installed on a breaker on a panel. Again, we must practice and we must train our people on how to do proper lockout tagout. And that's what OSHA recommends here. Lockout hardware and tags are to be furnished by the employer. You do not make your own locks or tags or attachments. You follow what your employer recommends. Again, here's a multi-lock installed. Sometimes we have what we call a complex lockout, and we'll be talking about that in a few minutes. Again, we have to do it right. After your lockout, we need to verify that the equipment will not start, move, or rotate. So we push in the buttons and we attempt to start the equipment after lockout, and that is one of our steps in our procedures. Under the NFPA 70-120.4 says, we have two different types of lockout procedures, lockout tagout procedures. One is a simple lockout, which only takes one qualified person. Again, de-energizing one source, and its employee is responsible for their own lockout tagout. And then we have the complex lockout. We talk about this in detail in the course, talks about multi-energy sources, multi-crews, multi-crafts, and we have boxes like so, like this one here, that most companies have. And again, you don't want to have five locks on one handle. It doesn't look too good. So we have a complex procedure on how we're going to do this. OSHA's 1910-333B talks about regulations for electrical lockout. again, talks about control devices may not be used as sole means of lockout. In other words, you must not lock out push buttons, selector switches, or interlocks. They're not designed to be locked out. Again, the end of this topic talks about lockout, tagout, lockout for life. The life you save may be your own. Always follow your company's recommended lockout, tagout procedures and policies. Next topic would be personal protective grounding. Again, very important. If we are doing de-energizing, some circuits may still be energized or continue to generate. So personal protective grounds, properly applied, are essential for doing work de-energized. Again, always make sure, verify that the circuit is totally dead before you apply any grounds. So personal protective grounds have two main purposes: to limit voltage rise, to ensure that the worker would not endure a shock at the fibrillation level. And these grounds also provide a low impedance path for short circuit currents to facilitate operation of protective devices. In other words, these grounds must bypass the majority of the current to earth if we are in parallel with the jumper. The only way to ensure that the system will remain de-energized is to short circuit or ground that system. Again, OSHA does not mandate grounding, and that can become a problem sometimes. So when do we ground, when do we not ground? We have to discuss that in our training session. On distribution lines and equipment, it is important to remember that it is not dead and that it is totally correctly grounded. So, all right, OSHA also talks about grounding in their article on their standard 1910-69 for generation, transmission, and distribution under letter N, applies to grounding and personal protective grounds applied correctly. Grounds will be applied with a live line tool according to OSHA's subpart 269 letter N. We must use hot sticks, extendo sticks, telescoping sticks, whatever we have, to make sure that we do not attach them while they could become energized. Again, grounding is always attached first and then the circuits or the phases last. And in order to remove them, we remove the phases first and then the ground and last. Never ever connect grounds barehanded at all. And this is covered in the class also. So the purpose of a protected grounds we talked about earlier, they provide maximum safety for people working on circuits that have been de-energized. They equalize the voltage difference. They basically put the person like a bird on a wire. And again, they minimize the magnitude and duration of the shock hazard. Grounding jumpers have to be proper. It's not one size fits all. So again, the closer you are to the source, the higher the short circuit fault current. So the bigger the ground jumper has to be. And all jumpers have to be tested. Here's how they test them. They check the phase, the surface of the clamp. They also test the clamp by itself, the cable by itself, and again, the other end of the jumper. And they all must pass individual resistance values. Now, most of the time, the cable is the weakest link when they do the test in a grounding jumper. So the cable is the one that always fails. Again, adequate ampacity must be able to, the cable must have ample adequate ampacity to withstand fault currents. Keep in mind that some circuits have reclosures and that fault's going to be available three more times or two more times. And again, that jumper must not break loose or melt or fuse. The resistance of the jumper must be low to allow most of the current to pass through the jumper and not the person that is doing the de-energized work. So it is important to remember that available fault currents are dependent upon the short circuit current studies. Again, so we choose our grounds when we do the assessment of the circuit, and protective device coordination studies must also be done by engineers necessary for determining the appropriate cable size. Notice we have a jumper here that looks green. This has oxidation. Copper basically oxidizes as soon as it makes contact with air. So these jumpers have to be tested and make sure they have a low impedance to make the correct jumper. Here's a diagram showing a jumper. On the left, you have the worker that basically we talked about earlier about 1,000 ohms. And on the right, we have a jumper that has a micro ohm resistance basically on there. And again, the current goes through the path of least resistance. Some will go through the person, but it must be less than the fibrillation level that we talked about at the beginning of the class. installation of grounds. Again, we have a ball socket grounding clamp on this picture here. And again, the bus for the ground goes on first, and then the faces. We don't recommend vendors, but here are the three most common places where you can find the best jumpers. We have Salisbury, Hastings, and AB Chance. Again, they are the most recommended locations where we can find PPE and again, jumpers also. The installation of ground must be excused if the employer can demonstrate. So grounds are not needed if they present a greater hazard. Sometimes ground jumpers may cause an accident. So again, that's why OSHA does not mandate installing jumpers or grounds sometimes. The jumpers are designed to discharge static charges and capacitively coupled voltages that could be on the line, electromagnetically coupled charges, and lightning in the circuit also can come through the power lines 10, 15 miles away. And if they're not grounded, the employee is going to be the ground jumper. So again, make sure that you use the proper type of grounding devices. The summary to the module, we talk about grounding requirements from OSHA. And again, if you're going to be doing de-energized work, the grounding is very important. And if it's not grounded, consider it energized. Our next topic is working with energized equipment. Again, here we have to be super careful. We have to be extra knowledgeable. We have to be qualified. We have to have training. So working on or near energized circuits or parts of equipment is very dangerous. Everybody knows that. It is necessary to necessary and acceptable under certain conditions. So we do work energized, again, but we sometimes may have to require or acquire a permit. So here's where we learn of what OSHA recommends. OSHA provides regulations for working on energized equipment and circuits. And the NFPA at 70E 2018 also provides the how to perform energized work safely. OSHA's definition of a qualified person is also discussed in the course. And the definition due to OSHA says one, and a qualified person is one who has received training in and has demonstrated skills and knowledge. The earlier definition said a person that is qualified has skills, but they have changed it now to a person that is qualified has to demonstrate skills and knowledge in the construction, operation of electrical equipment and installations and hazards involved. In other words, if you know the hazards, the construction and the operation, you're on your way to being qualified. NFPA 70E also adds that a qualified person has received safety training to identify the hazards and reduce the associated risk. Remember, the hazards are what causes accidents, equipment, environment, and work practices. All work facilities and job tests must be assessed for dangers or hazards according to OSHA. So it's a responsibility of the employer to make sure that they assess the work area so nobody gets hurt or killed. OSHA's 1910-332, Section A talks about the training requirements contained for a qualified person in this section apply to employees who face a risk of electric shock that is not reduced to a safe level by the electrical installation requirements of OSHA's 1910-303 through 308. And again, not only electrical equipment have to be trained, but also unqualified people. And the type of training that OSHA recommends is classroom, on the job. And the NFPA also says a combination of the two would be a lot better. And the training should be determined by the risk to the employee. How much training also depends on the danger. Again, just changing a fuse or a light bulb, you don't need very much training. But if you're going to be doing live work, it requires extensive training by equipment. All right, moving on to OSHA's PPE requirements. We require that we wear proper protection equipment. And when the employee should know when the PPE is necessary. What PPE is necessary and how to don and doff this equipment. Keep in mind that fly suits are also required in some location. We need to make sure that we know how to check them and inspect all this stuff. The employer must also know the limitations of the PPE and the proper care maintenance, how to wash, how to safely store all this stuff also. Additional refresher training must be done if the company supervisors, again, do an annual inspection And it indicates that some people are non-complying or they're not following safety procedures. Or if technology changes or the equipment changes, we need to retrain again, or if procedures change, we need to retrain our employees. Training shall establish employee proficiency in the workplace. Regulatory requirements for energized work. So OSHA says that the employer does not, if the employer does not de-energize, then a suitable safe work practice shall be done for the conditions under which the work is to be performed, and shall include in writing a procedure and strictly enforced. Energized work permit is required. Again, we in the permit, we have to put the description of work to be done, the location of the work, why we're doing the work energized, very important, and what safe work practices are going to be used, and the results of the arc and shock risk assessment must also be included in the work permit. Again, working on or near energized parts, the standards recommend that only qualified employees may work in areas containing unguarded, uninsulated energized lines or parts of equipment operating at 50 volts or more. So, working near exposed energized works, only qualified people can work on or near. OSHA has a standard where it says that two people are required if you're going to be working 600 volts or above. But this standard also has an exception where one person can do the job. And we talk about that in the class again, where two people are required and one person can do the class. Again, OSHA's exception says two people are not required if we're doing routine switching, or we're doing work to emergency and an emergency to safeguard the public, one person can do it. And if that person is totally qualified, trained, and is using proper lifeline tools and keeps the proper distance, one person can do it safely. We have protection boundaries for the shock covered under table 3 of this course. And again, we have two different limitations. We have the limited approach boundary and the restricted approach boundary. Notice on the limited approach boundary, it has two columns. The restricted approach boundary only has one column because we have locations where we have conductors that are movable and conductors that are fixed. So we discussed that on the course. And now we have DC tables for protection boundaries. Again, we have two limited approach boundaries for DC and one for limited, and one column for restricted for DC voltages and work. Again, this is the picture we took out of the NFPA 70E, and that shows the limits of approach. The two red dark circles are the shock protection boundaries, and the blue dotted line is the arc flash protection boundary. Now, all this is to protect personnel. OSHA also has information under work on confined or enclosed spaces where the space contains exposed energized parts or circuits. The employer shall provide protection. Employees shall use protection to work in confined locations. And if that confined area has doors or hinges, they must be secured, attached, or tied up. Where we have to use ladders, ladders must have non-conductive side rails, again, to protect the personnel from contact with energized circuits. And again, make sure that you don't use total aluminum ladders when working electrical circuits. Conductive apparel must not be worn while wearing this, when working on energized circuits, like metal jewelry, watches, key rings, tool belts, metalized clothing, metal headgear. Of course, you're not going to wear a hard hat that's made of metal. But again, we never know. Interlocks, the standard says interlocks should never be defeated. And they have an exception to that on this rule, that if the interlock has to be defeated, it can only be done by a qualified person, and it must be returned to operational way or condition, after it has been defeated only by a qualified person. OSHA also talks about clear spaces, and the National Electrical Code says clear space in front of equipment shall not be used for storage. We must not put anything that impedes us from getting to that equipment for operation or for maintenance, again, to open the doors or remove the panels. If we anticipate failures, the work must be done de-energized and protect the employees from danger. Sometimes equipment may give you a little warning. It starts to hiss or arc or spark. And again, that is, anticipated failure. Something's going to go wrong. Primary protective equipment for energized work. We have rubber insulating equipment. We have rubber gloves. Everybody must know what class of glove they need. Again, this equipment shall protect specific parts of the body according to OSHA. Again, if you're gonna protect your hands, you wear gloves, you're gonna protect your sleeve, your arms, you wear sleeves. And again, whenever doing energized work. We also need arc-rated clothing for working around equipment. We have two types of arc-rated clothing. We have the daily wear and we have the arc flash suits. Again, getting back to insulated and uninsulated tools can cause short circuits, ground faults. So only qualified personnel shall work near exposed energized work conductors and must use insulated tools also. The summary to personal protective equipment, again, we went through real quick or real fast. On the 4-day course, we actually show students how to basically take care of equipment again and what the manufacturer recommends also. If possible, avoid doing energized work at all. If done, make sure you have approval, make sure you have permits, and make sure you do it safe. You must be qualified to perform the task energized, follow your company's requirements. Personal protective equipment continued. Again, OSHA mandates that hazard assessment be done if we're gonna be doing energized work and wear the proper PPEs. We must select the proper materials, proper equipment. PPE and protective measures must be employed to protect employees from job-related hazards. Shock protection is available, again, from 500 volts all the way to 36,000 volts. So in this section, we talked about years of development and research have improved our arc flash protection equipment. It is now easier to wear, softer. And again, we need to have information from the manufacturer. Many different materials are used in the manufacturing of this arc flash suits, and there are several methods available to protect personnel from the blast pressures and the blast danger. Insulation provides insulation to a barrier to the body of an employee. It must be voltage rated, it must be clean. And again, the standards require that we guard. Guarding prevents coming too close to energized circuits. Like installing signs or barricades, again, signs or an attendant also. Here's a sign that we use to keep people out of our energized locations. Or we can use a tape or a non-conductive chain or devices and signs. Or we can use an attendant. We use one of our employees to make sure that nobody comes in contact. Electrical protective equipment is also covered in this program. We talk about the shock protection, the arc flash protection, and the blast protection. We also see what OSHA recommends, that says OSHA employees working in areas where there are potential hazards, they shall be protected and use protective equipment. Under OSHA's 1910-137 provides information for the design of the equipment. The manufacturer's information in use and care of this equipment is also must be provided. And temporary insulation equipment based on the ACM standards. Again, we have a table here that talks about class of gloves and the voltages they are tested at, and the use voltage is very important. Inspection of equipment also must be done according to manufacturers. Follow the specific requirements that apply to insulating equipment. Make sure you have the proper or the maximum use voltage and inspect your equipment. And all gloves should be given an air test. Here's a device that will inflate your glove. Again, there's several vendors that have this type of equipment. Insulation equipment shall be cleaned and free from moisture. Also, insulating equipment shall be stored to protect it from ultraviolet light, temperature extremes, and excessive humidity. So again, protect it from sunlight. And we have protectors that go over the gloves. And the standard says that gloves can be used without protectors if you need finger dexterity. So look at here and see what you have to do. You have to derate the glove, basically one class, if you're going to be taking the protector off. The protector has to be a distance from the end of the glove. In other words, the gauntlet has to be a certain distance from the cuff. And here's what they recommend for the type or the class of glove. We recommend a half inch all the way from 4-0 to 0-0 gloves and 1 inch per class for the other four gloves. Gloves shall be tested electronically or electrically every 6 months, blankets every year, line hoses and hot sticks upon indication that insulation is suspected. Unless your hot sticks are going to be primary protection, then you have to test your hot sticks every 2 years. There are two types of arc protective clothing, the daily wear, like I mentioned earlier, and the arc flash suits. Employees must be trained to identify the hazards of flames, and employees cannot wear clothing that could basically increase their injuries. Here are two different typical flash suits. Now, again, the color does not mean anything. We need to know the value of the ATPV on the equipment. Arc-rated clothing must be inspected before you put it on, and we must know how to wash and dry. According to the manufacturer's information, do not use bleach or softeners. And again, insect repellents that have DEET are also prohibited. Arc flash hazard training must be done also according to the standards. We must have safety rules and that are written, and training and safety audit to ensure compliance with all of this stuff. For protection of blast, we have arc blast blankets, distance. We have ear canal insert protection for hearing, and body position is very important. We also have blast blankets that are available from manufacturers, and your hearing protection in canal insert. Here's a dual range hearing protector that we can find at our local Granger store. Again, positioning the body to the hinge side is very important. And again, wearing equipment, non-conductive head protection. Again, make sure your hard head is either letter G or a class E for 20,000 volts. Eye protection, we need safety glasses, face shield, eye and body wash facilities if we're going to be exposed to corrosive materials. And if we're going to be doing or handling energized equipment, we must use approved insulated tools. Again, testing for energy. We're going to be de-energizing or checking a life circuit. We must have the proper rated tool. On the left, we have the low voltage tester or meter. On the right side, we have the medium voltage to high voltage tester or detector. The summary to this PPE module, we talked about electrical protective equipment must be used and will be available for the employees. And again, make sure that we all wear and follow instructions. General requirements according to OSHA is also discovered on this class. We talk about OSHA requirements for an examination, installation of use of electrical equipment. Remember, equipment causes accidents, so OSHA recommends that we make sure that we use approved equipment, that it's installed correctly and maintained properly according to manufacturers. Recommendation. Examination, OSHA says that we must examine equipment before you mess with it, before you touch it. Give it a visual check. Make sure it doesn't have any signs of problems. Installation and use. Again, all equipment must be labeled and tested according to underwriters' laboratories or other labeling entities. Here we have several stickers that we find on our equipment. Again, we cannot make our own because then we void the listing. Identification of connecting means for circuits must be labeled and marked correctly. Again, all circuits that go to motors and appliances, services, and branch circuits, most of this information is found on the National Electrical Code, but also in our classes. Identification of disconnecting means. Identification. Again, never label them Joe's office or Sam's lab because Joe may move to another office and now we are de-energizing or working on the wrong circuit. The use of portable equipment. Again, if you're going to be using equipment that's portable, again, list general requirements for handling of all this equipment. We must inspect our portable equipment. If it's a cord or plug connected equipment, again, make sure that it's handled in a proper manual. Proper way. Visual inspection must be done on all our equipment before we handle it or work with it. And again, visual inspection shall be inspected before any shift, inspected before external damage, and process inspect for possible internal damage also. The use of GFCIs is also required in some locations, especially if we're doing modification, remodeling, or construction. We have GFCIs that are available. Again, and we must test this devices also periodically. OSHA talks about power and lighting circuits, routine opening of breakers or circuits under load. The device must be designed to open under load. It must have a load rated switch It must be a circuit breaker or other device especially made or designed to open under load. Cable connectors are not load break. Fuses are not supposed to be used to open load or under load. Terminal lugs, cable splice connectors, again, are not designed for shedding load, except in an emergency. Electric power and light circuits, again, talked about reclosing circuits after the device has operated. OSHA recommend that if the breaker trips, it must be found out what caused the breaker to trip. Unless it's load, then it can be reset. If it's load caused the breaker to trip. Again, working along electrical spaces along with electrical equipment. Again, using workspaces, we must know the clear workspace, dedicated space in front and sides and top of equipment, also is covered in this course. Again, electrical work equipment intended to allow employees enough room to work safely. Clear space must be in front and around and the back if we have anything to replace on the back of the equipment. Again, general requirements, readily accessible definition is that we can get to the equipment properly. Here we have a picture where the doors of the equipment do not open 90 degrees, and that is a violation. Again, workspace in front of equipment depends on the voltage. 3 foot for voltages for one to from 0 to 600 volts. Again, shown here. Again, 151 volts to 600 volts. And we have greater than 600 volts. We have to have a certain distance to make sure that we can work safe. And clear space in front of equipment shown here. A dedicated space for headroom is also discussed on the class. Workspace for electrical equipment for rear access. If there's nothing that we can change or modify or any fuses or switches behind the equipment can be placed all the way to the back to the wall. Again, restrictions for electrical equipment. Entrance to rooms and other guard locations must contain gates or, again, warning signs forbidding unqualified people to enter. Here's one of the signs that we use for our electrical locations. Again, guarding rooms and spaces, fences, screens, partitions, or walls shall enclose the rooms and other spaces to minimize the possibility of an unqualified person getting hurt or injured. OSHA recommends that we have medical services, first aid equipment, again, that we have CPR training, and also that we know how to attend a person that has a problem or medical or has gotten a shock, for that matter. Again, first aid, where the eyes or body of a person may be exposed to injurious corrosive, a suitable drenching or flushing for eyes and body shall be provided within the work area. Medical services for state covers and responding to a shock. How do we remove a person or how do we basically release a person that's getting shocked also is covered under OSHA standards for safety. Job briefing is a requirement when we must have a meeting before we start any work, especially if we're working in confined work spaces. Again, requires that we follow OSHA's recommended 1910-146. The summary to a permanent system, I'm sorry, for proper work was talked about OSHA and compliance with the requirements ensures that we are working safe. Permanent grounding systems, again, for locations where we have to attach earth, industry derives the grounding bonding from the NFPA 70, which is the National Electrical Code, Article 250. And we talked about OSHA and IEEE's information on grounding. OSHA documents approximately 20,000 grounding violations, where again, remember when I said people don't know the difference between earth, between ground and neutral. If a ground fault occurs, the equipment enclosure shall become energized unless it's properly grounded. And keep in mind that people are stealing copper, so that ground may not be installed, may not be good or correct. Again, we talk about system grounds for for the neutral is the grounding conductor and the grounded conductors for the earth, for shorts. Again, the purpose of ground systems to limit the voltage to ground on systems in case of line surges. And again, they're designed to protect equipment. So we're talking about the grounded conductors. The equipment ground provides protection for workers for workers and others who work making contact with electrical equipment. It provides a low impedance path for fault current to flow back to the supply. Again, grounds are essential to understand the function of when they're needed. Again, improper grounds can be time bombs. The National Electrical Code again talks about grounding systems for service grounds under Article 250.4 and what they do. Again, Article 250.4A2 talks about equipment grounding. And if ground conductors and grounding conductors or non-current carrying equipment are connected on the load side, a parallel path can be created that will have a difference impedance and a difference in potential, and the shock or the touch potential hazard can occur. We talk about different grounding electrodes also in the course. We have supplemental grounds also that we discuss. Our typical ground rod should be an 8-foot ground rod again, and it should be installed below grade for protection. Again, forbidden electrodes, again, metal underground gas pipes are not supposed to be used for grounds. Aluminum electrodes are not allowed, and other stuff. Grounding electrical conductors. Now, the wire, again, must be proper size and must be protected. If it's in the smaller than number 6, American well shall be protected from physical harm with some kind of a conduit or EMT device. System grounding connections, again, must be acceptable. Grounding connectors, again, there are a whole bunch of listed connectors that we can use for grounding. Exothermic grounding is also used in substations. So grounded connectors must meet the following requirements. Their ampacity must be proper. They must not deteriorate with age, and they must be able to withstand repeated faults. For high voltage system grounds, we have ground grids in substations that limit dangerous potentials for the step potential hazard. And these grounds are connected to provide a parallel path for current for transfer of potentials. So the person in the substation is going to be like a bird on a wire. Again, we have high voltage grounding systems for equipotential grounding. We can also do insulation and isolation. If we put a grounding mat, like we see in this picture, again, the person is at the same potential at the system if the mat is properly grounded. Or we can isolate that with insulation. Again, that person floating from ground with a rubber mat. And again, ground fences must be connected to the grid. All equipment in a substation is connected to ground. Substation fences and gates must be attached to ground, again, with a bonding jumper. Again, also barbed wire and fences shown here with a proper strap. Again, the barbed wire must be grounded. And the fence posts, if there are lighting posts or equipment posts here, again, shown bonded to the grid underground, underneath the gravel. IEEE talks a lot about grounding also. The Green Book, if we need more information, and recommends periodic measurements of this ground, so we have to test them. Here we have the three-point fallout potential for testing our grounds. The summary to grounding, we talked about bounding ground is necessary for protection of people also. It's essential that we ground our systems and have a low impedance path to ground. Again, maintenance is the key to keeping people safe. So again, we need to have people aware of what can cause problems to people. And Jamie, we are done with the course. And thank you everybody for being an attentive listener. And here's Jamie back to give you some information. Do not go away.
All right, thank you, Ralph. Just wanted to just go over, I know Ralph, I mentioned this earlier and Ralph mentioned it a few times, just for anybody that missed it, we do offer a more in-depth course on the topic today that we discussed. This was obviously, a pretty quick overview with a lot to cover in just an hour. I think Ralph did a really good job, but there's obviously a lot more that, which is the reason it's a 4-day course normally. So. But with that being said, I wanted to remind everyone, if you haven't already submitted any questions, you can do so now. We have had some questions come in, but feel free to go ahead and submit additional questions at this time. And we're going to try to answer as many as possible at about 20, probably take about 20 minutes since we went a little over the presentation. but feel free to do that. Also, before we get started with the questions, just a reminder that there will be a survey once you close out the webinar window. We appreciate it if you could fill that out, just to leave any feedback possible, so we can improve upon future webinars. There's also a section in the survey where you can request a quote or more information if you want one of our salespeople to reach out to you with additional information about courses or any other questions you might have, or if you have another specific question offline for Ralph, we can get those answered in the next couple weeks as well. So just want to make you aware of that, and let's go ahead and get to some of your questions now. The first one, Ralph, was asked by Shahid. He asked, for a worker to be qualified, he or she must receive electrical safety training and must be familiar with construction and operation of equipment. Can he or she receive the training for the second part from one of their experienced qualified coworkers?
That's correct. A qualified person can train the person on the construction, the operation, and the hazards. Also, all three things, it can be done by a qualified person at work. Again, field training is also allowed. So make sure that they document, though. Make sure that they write down who did the training, again, how what the training was about, and again, archive this training.
Okay. Thank you, Rob. Next question was, do we need arc flash labels on 120 volt panels?
Negative. Arc flash basically is calculated over 208 volts. Anything that's 208 or above, we require an assessment.
Okay. Thank you. Next question was from Ronald. Are MCC rooms required to be locked or just restricted to authorized employees?
Yes, restricted to unqualified employees.
Okay. All right, next question was, do arc flash rated electrical panels need to be certified by any third party agency?
That's a question for engineers.
Okay.
We'll get back.
Okay, we'll get back to you on that one. All right, next question was from Todd. If 4160 VAC coded bus work that is said to be properly maintained but only guarded with an expanded metal guard considered a no arc blast hazard that is fed by 8.3 megawatt bulb hydro turbine generator?
Thank you, Todd, for that question. Tongue twister there. Anytime you remove a metal cover, it's considered energized. Even though the bus is covered with a material, it is not insulation. So once you take off the metal cover, you must be qualified and must have all the proper PPE available.
Okay, thank you. Next question was from Aaron. For the infeasible due to operational limitations, do you have any comment on what that means in terms of a plant operator simply saying that they cannot shut down the process?
Yes, sometimes we have a justification because, ventilation equipment. Sometimes we have locations where we're manufacturing or manipulating chemicals and fumes and stuff like that. That's infeasible to de-energize. For some places we have lighting circuits, mines, tunnels. And again, we must not mess with that. It could cause somebody to get killed or injured. Did that answer the question?
I hope so. If not, if you have any more questions, Aaron, or need more, just let me know on that one, or we can respond to it offline in more detail. Okay, next question was from Charles. Being a qualified worker has to show demonstrated skills. Do licensed electricians qualified for watching the worker and qualify him or her?
I'm most likely a qualified person is considered to have the skills and knowledge to again monitor and also supervise. So yes.
Okay. Next question was from William. What is the proper level of safety training for a non-electrical worker to enter a substation? In parentheses, always are they? Do they always have to be escorted?
As there's two questions there. One, for a non-qualified person, the training can be limited to 1 day or 2 days for unqualified. AVO has courses for unqualified personnel. And again, a qualified person can escort a non-qualified person into the limited approach boundary, but not the restricted approach boundary. So the qualified person needs to know how far that unqualified person can go into. Again, no unqualified person shall be allowed to go beyond the limited approach boundary.
Okay. Next question was from Shahid. You said gloves shall be inspected inside and outside. Please explain the inside inspection.
Yes, in the course that I was talking about today, we basically explain or demonstrate the inspection of a glove, how to apply air or trap air inside the glove, and then turn it inside out and look for any signs of scratches or damage that is visible. Again, most holes can be found when you turn the glove inside out. But make sure you don't leave it inside out. Make sure you turn it back inside in. And also, again, we teach students to make sure that they store the glove in a canvas bag, not in a plastic or other type of bag, because condensation can damage the rubber. So again, if you wash it with water, make sure you dry it and put it back the proper way that it was if you turned it inside out.
Okay, thank you, Ralph.
You're welcome.
Let's see. Next question was from David. Does an air conditioning technician who is performing troubleshooting on an AC condenser, are they required to complete an energized work permit?
That depends on the company. Also, your policies, your procedures. Again, check with your company, see if you do need a permission to work energized. OSHA says that all maintenance shall be done de-energized. So again, but if you're going to have to check the circuit, the compressor, all that stuff, the only way you can do it sometimes is energized. So again, that might be exempt. All right, check with the check with your employer.
All right. Next question was from Timothy. Where do batteries fall in working with live electrical equipment?
Batteries considered always energized work. So when we're working with batteries, we must have the proper PPE, we must have the proper insulated tools. You cannot turn off a battery. So it's always energized. Again, protect number one when you're working with batteries.
Next question was from Scott. How do you train companies to meet this requirement of 110.1.H.2 human error? The risk assessment shall address the potential for human error.
All right. The engineer that's doing the assessment or the analysis, they change from analysis to assessment now, must determine what are the chances of a person tripping, falling, again causing a fault, and again that they go from low, medium to high. So that must be included in the assessment also, and that will be another engineering question.
Okay. All right. Next question was from Steve. I've noticed that some of the available fault current values posted on the arc flash labels are higher in low voltage equipment than in high voltage equipment, in which will require less PPE. Can you tell me why that's the case when most people know the higher voltages are more dangerous?
Yes, because the arc flash is not voltage sensitive. You can create a bigger fault or bigger arc flash, I'm sorry, at lower voltages. We're talking about 480, 208. Then you can do a 13,000 volt system because it's not voltage. It's not the voltage that causes the arc flash. It's the voltage and the current together, which is called energy or power. And again, when that is combined with the impedance of the circuit, the resistance of the circuit, you can actually create a bigger arc fault at 480 than you can at 5 kV or 13 kV. So again, that's what the assessment is for, to make sure that we have the proper equipment, the proper protection, no matter the voltage.
All right. Thank you, Ralph. Next question is from Ronald. Can you explain again what panels are required to be labeled for arc flash?
I am not very sure, but last time I heard was anything that's not residential, anything that's not like meter loops or not do not need a label, and transformers, I believe. But check with your engineering people to see if they can find out. But last I heard was residential circuits do not need labels, watt-hour meter sockets or boxes do not need labels, and I believe transformers don't need labels. All right?
All right. Okay, next question. Is there any OSHA standard pertaining to electrical room that cannot be used as a maintenance storage or working station?
Yes, there is. You can find that out on your OSHA regulations under equipment rooms. I forgot the number, but we can get back and give them the OSHA standard for that.
Okay. All right. Next question was from Susan. Is it ever appropriate for workers to be adding a new breaker to a live panel? And if so, must arc flash PPE be required?
Yes. If it's going to be 208 volts or above, they must wear the proper PPE and they must have an assessment of what the possibilities of an arc flash that can happen. It's just replacing a breaker. You are, as soon as you're in what they call it, interacting with that equipment over 208 volts, an arc flash may be available. So, yes.
Okay. Next question was from Robert. Do you teach how the incident energy analysis is calculated in your course? Same for the risk assessment?
No, we don't. We just talk about it. It would take about 2 days to basically go over all the information on the formulas and softwares and stuff like that.
Okay. All right. Next question was from Sean too. How often should a refresher course be taken? Like once a year or more?
The standards recommend that we retrain if we notice that employees are not following safety rules or policies, if they're non-compliant, if they're wearing their hard hat backwards, stuff like that. But employers can actually retrain every 3 years, and that's what the standard recommends.
Okay. Next question was from Ronald. It is my understanding that OSHA will not cite against NFPA 70E requirements. How do we convince sites to commit to NFPA 70E?
NFPA 70E is not a policy book. It's not a citation book. But anytime you violate a NFPA 70E standard, remember, they came from OSHA. So you're violating OSHA standards, and you can be cited for that.
Okay.
By OSHA.
Next question was from James. In what situations would installing ground jumpers create a hazard?
Very, very simple. Installing ground jumpers, the circuit can become energized or have static on it, and an arc can develop. So again, we must not assume that just because it's bare or it's a ground that it's not going to be hot. A fault can come back through the ground while you're installing grounds and explode. So again, always anticipate that something might become energized. What's that Murphy's Law? If it can go wrong, it will. So that's what we teach in this class.
Okay, thank you, Ralph.
You're welcome.
Next question, if one or more contractors are working on equipment, do all the contractors need to do a live test after de-energization individually?
Yes. How do you know the other crew did it correctly? So I recommend that, or the standards recommend that we do live anytime we are going to be exposed. So again, never trust. In my courses, I tell my students, never trust your mother. If she tells you it's dead, I still check myself. You never know.
Okay. And we're running out of time, and we do have, you know, additional questions. We actually had a lot of questions on this one.
All right.
For just one more question, if you don't mind, Ralph, and then the rest we'll answer those offline.
Sure.
Last from Steven, is there a working clearance for medium voltage cables laying in a cable tray or free aired in vaults?
Yes, depends on the voltage. Again, we must keep it clear so we can have access to that equipment or that circuit. So again, we must, only if it's exposed, okay? When it's exposed, we must have clearance.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much, Ralph, for the presentation. I want to thank everybody for attending today. Please fill out the survey if you get a chance, and we appreciate you all being here. We want to hope everyone's staying safe during these times. Hope you and your families are well. And we hope to see you at, you know, our future webinars as well.
Also, guys, we have this course is in Spanish also.
Okay. Thank you, Ralph. Yes.
You're welcome,
so if you have any other questions about, you know, the full course as well, just reach out to us. We'll be happy to answer those for you. All right. And that's it. Thank you again, and have a great weekend, everybody.
Thank you. Bye.